I will say, get it right here on Star News.
New time, Thursday nights at 9 o'clock.
Are you going to church only to find a club? Are you tired of looking for the Bible but only getting babble? If you want to find people who are studying God's Word, come examine the Church of Christ. We're meeting right here at 250 The Boulevard in downtown Eden. If you want to hear more plain Bible teaching, watch A Word from the Lord Thursday nights at 9 o'clock right here on WGSR.
The views expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect the views of the station, its employees, or ownership.
I couldn't stand Johnny at first. I thought he was a nut. And once I read the Bible for myself, I'm able to accept the truth now.
All right.
And it doesn't make me angry.
I'm talking about the Lauren Hardy Show on Wednesday. Don't worry about them. Some of y'all, get off of it, would you? Don't dare do that again. Shut that up. Shut that up. Shut that up.
As your pastor, I am telling you, please, don't waste your time on Wednesday nights watching this television program.
If you're looking for Laurel and Hardy, I left my derby and I left my cane, but I did bring my Bible. If you'll read along with me, you'll find that the persons who are making the accusations, they're really the ones who have a problem. I hear them telling you to shut up, that you're going to be embarrassed, and I even hear them flat out saying, I'm telling you what to do as a pastor. Give me a chance and I'll give you what does the Bible say. Always ask for what does the Bible say. Get it right here on Star News.
New time, Thursday nights at 9 o'clock.
Are you going to church only to find a club? Are you tired of looking for the Bible but only getting babble? If you want to find people who are studying God's Word, come examine the Church of Christ. We're meeting right here at 250 The Boulevard in downtown Eden. If you want to hear more plain Bible teaching, watch A Word from the Lord Thursday nights at 9 o'clock right here on WGSR.
I couldn't stand Johnny at first. I thought he was a nut. And once I read the Bible for myself, I'm able to accept the truth now.
All right.
And it doesn't make me angry.
I'm talking about the Lauren Hardy Show on Wednesday. Don't worry about them. Some of y'all, get off of it, would you? Don't dare do that again. Shut that up. Shut that up. Shut that up.
As your pastor, I am telling you, please, don't waste your time on Wednesday nights watching this television program.
If you're looking for Laurel and Hardy, I left my derby and I left my cane, but I did bring my Bible. If you'll read along with me, you'll find that the persons who are making the accusations, they're really the ones who have a problem. I hear them telling you to shut up, that you're going to be embarrassed, and I even hear them flat out saying, I'm telling you what to do as a pastor. Give me a chance and I'll give you what does the Bible say. Always ask for what does the Bible say. Get it right here on Star News.
New time, Thursday nights at 9 o'clock.
Are you going to church only to find a club? Are you tired of looking for the Bible but only getting babble? If you want to find people who are studying God's Word, come examine the Church of Christ. We're meeting right here at 250 The Boulevard in downtown Eden. If you want to hear more plain Bible teaching, watch A Word from the Lord Thursday nights at 9 o'clock right here on WGSR.
The views expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect the views of the station, its employees, or ownership.
All right, good evening, everyone. Welcome to A Word from the Lord. Welcome back to the place where you can always get a Bible answer to your Bible question. If you always ask, what does the Bible say, you'll get A Word from the Lord. And so I'm glad to be back in town and glad to be with you, and hope you're ready for a continuation of study from God's Word. Here's our information. If you would like to be with us, 250 The Boulevard there in Eden, you can reach me at 276-340-2653 or 336-394-5721, and I'll be glad to meet with you at your convenience. Wordfromthelord@gmail.com is my email address, and we hope that you will avail yourself of that. Tonight I'm going to be answering some email questions are some things that we've been getting via email or over the internet, discussing that topic tonight. I wanted to remind you of where you can meet with the saints here in this area in 823 Starling Avenue. And as you heard mentioned earlier, they're having a friends and family month, I think. That's a good way to put it. They're starting, I think, next Sunday. and then 120 American Legion in Danville. If you are in that area, you can worship there with the saints there. And as always, you'll be welcomed, and you will always be given the opportunity to ask Bible questions or ask any questions about why you're doing what you're doing. So, okay, the friends and family is the next Sunday. It's not this coming Sunday. This is the 13th. Okay. Anyway, the 20th, starting 20th. So, anyway, you know, friends, one of the things that we're always talking about is rightly dividing the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15. What that simply means is getting out of the Bible what God put in it. Now, one of the things that we discuss and one of the things we challenge individuals to find is authority for why they do what they do. See, the reason why we're concerned about it is because we know that we have to get out what God put in, and we're constantly wanting you to ask your pastor, bishop, rabbi, whoever it may be, why it is that you do what you do. Why is it that you do what you do? Why is it do you have women preachers? Why do y'all tithe? Why do y'all meet at a certain time? Why do you worship on Saturday instead of Sunday? Or why do you take the Lord's Supper however frequent you do? Ask these questions. Now, you may not think it's important, but I'm telling you, friends, it is important. Because if you are going to rightly divide the word of truth and be a workman that need not be ashamed, 2 Timothy 2:15, you are going to have to ask of why you're doing what you're doing. We want you to ask that of us. I mean, Peter said in 1 Peter 3:15 that we ought to be ready to always to give an answer to everyone that asketh us a reason of the hope that's within us with meekness and fear. So we want you to realize that asking questions is not a bad thing. I know the old preacher a while back told Micah that he didn't have any right to question him, since Micah was only 20-something and this man had been preaching for however many years. Well, that's the very thing you're supposed to do. This man has been preaching for so many years and read the Bible so many times. He's supposed to ask a question. He's the one who's supposed to be able to give an answer. So we want to challenge you to give an answer. And we are doing this because we're always looking for authority. Now, I know that's kind of a foreign subject to some. Some of the, well, what difference does it make authority this, authority that? You know what? One reason why our country is in such a big uprising right now, dealing with the tea parties and so everything, the marches and everything on Washington, is because the government is trying to do things that the Constitution doesn't give them authority for. And if you are not concerned about authority, whether it be in the government, whether it be in your regular life or school, whatever, if you're not concerned about authority, then you're basically saying, I don't care what happens. Anybody can do anything to me because I don't have the authority or I don't have any rights, or I can do anything to anybody else because that's what I want to do. You see, authority works both ways. Authority protects, and it also gives you rights to do something on how to act. So we're looking for authority. We're looking for authority. Now, we ask our religious neighbors that all the time. We ask them, why do you do what you do? And we ask them to give an answer about why they're doing what they're doing. They can't do it oftentimes. They have to call in and have their pastor or their bishop or their preacher, whoever it might be. They have to give them to give an answer. And they don't want to do it. But you need to know why. And so we're not doing something that we wouldn't want you to do to us. As a matter of fact, the verse that everybody brings up to us that seems to be the one they draw like a dagger or like a gun is Matthew 7 and verse 1 and 2. Look at this. Judge not that you be not judged, for with what judgment you judge, you shall be judged, and with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. Friends, we don't mind you judging us by the standard by which we judge everybody else. As a matter of fact, we actually welcome it. If you will judge us by the Bible, that is, give, you know, examine what we're saying and doing by the Bible, then we would appreciate it. You'll be our friend. We're not doing anything that the Bible condemns. Actually, what we're doing is what the Bible tells us to do. In John 7, verse 24, Jesus said, judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. So we're doing what God says do, and that's what we want you to do to us. We want you to give an answer about why you're doing what you're doing. Now, here's what I want you to consider too, friends. While we're asking you to give an answer, I want you to know that we're fair even to ourselves. Did you know that we actually ask the same question about our brethren? When we find brethren who are doing things, we might ask them, well, why are you doing this? Where do you get the authority to do this? You know, by whose authority are you engaging in this certain activity or worshiping in such a way? And that's fine. That's fine because that's what the Bible says for us to do. But we ask that same question of ourselves. I've been on the road traveling and I've been visiting with a lot of different people. And one of the things that came up in a conversation that I had with some older Christians was the fact that, we do things, but we don't really know why we do them. We just kind of go on routine. And I said, you know what will stop that? What will stop that is you start converting individuals who don't know about the Church of Christ or who come out of a denomination or who have never studied the Bible. And when they start really looking into the Bible, they'll start looking at everything you do and they'll start acting like a little child and they'll start asking why. They'll say, why? Why do we do that? Why do we do that? And you'll start having to give an answer why. Things that you never even thought about before. Things that you've forgotten about why you do it. You may be doing it right, but you'll have to start asking and answering those questions about why. And we do that with ourselves. As a matter of fact, tonight's lesson has to do with something that a brother in Christ actually has asked of us. Now, this is a topic that came to us over the internet, and it has to do with a greater understanding of this very thing. Now, you say that, that's a strange word, James. What possibly could come up, what could the topic be that would make you want to discuss a metonymy? You might say, well, no, that's metonymy is what that word is. And that is simply a figure of speech of putting one thing for another. And the topic that we're going to be discussing has to do with this very thing. Now, you may not remember what that word is, but I want you to remember what it is. It's simply a figure of speech. Listen, friends, when God speaks to us, He speaks to us in languages or in ways that we can understand. We talk to each other in a certain way in order to get people to understand, and we use figures of speech. God does the same thing. God uses a figure of speech that's called a metonymy. And that is simply putting one thing for another. For example, look how God uses it. In 2 Corinthians 3:15, Paul said, "But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart." Now, how do you read Moses? See, you can't read Moses, the man, but you can read what he wrote. You can read the things that he has written down or the things that he's recorded, and that is reading Moses. Somebody might say, "Well, what are you reading?" Well, I've been reading from Shakespeare. You know, well, you haven't been reading the man. You've actually been reading what the man wrote. But the metonymy is putting the man for what he wrote. Now, God uses that kind of language, friends. And if you don't understand that and you miss that, then you'll make a big mistake. You may make a mistake, and it may be a really big mistake, that'll cause you to go off in a direction that will lead you to doing things that you shouldn't be doing, or that you don't need to do, or even worse, lead you to do things that would make you think that not doing those things is wrong. So you need to understand what God is saying. You need to understand how God talks, and that's what we're dealing with. We're going to look at an example of why we need to know how to rightly divide the word of truth. I'm trying to give you a lesson tonight, friends, to show you that this is why we need to know how to write and divide the word of truth. You may think it's something very insignificant. You may think it's not important. You may think it's something that is so childish and useless that you shouldn't even waste your time. But I tell you, friends, this problem of not understanding how God talks and not understanding what God is saying can only lead to misunderstanding what God says, and that's where you get in trouble. And this particular subject that we're talking about tonight may not be a big deal to you. But I can assure you that the problems that produce the issue we're talking about tonight are the same problems that will arise and cause people to do whatever they want to do in religion. Same problem, and that is not knowing about the authority, not knowing why you do what you do. Now, the subject tonight. What we're talking about is something, as I said, a fellow emailed me, wanted to know if I would comment on this on the air. These people are watching on the internet. And I recently saw that one of the viewers over the internet has actually posted a video about this particular subject. And I actually got the opportunity to discuss or to talk with these individuals as I traveled through Arkansas and met with them. And so I'm going to address that issue tonight. And hopefully that it will help those individuals who've been asking about it give them some information on this subject, but also help you, even though you may not have this problem, help you to say, yeah, you know, I can see where that would be a big issue. I can see where if the same or different problems may arise from the same for the same reason, people not understanding how God talks. Now, what we've been discussing is the Lord's Supper. In particular, how many vessels you have to use when you partake of the Lord's Supper. Now, I know some of you out there are so far off on authority that you think it's not even important to take the Lord's Supper. I read your writings. You think, well, once a quarter is all right. Once every 6 weeks is all right. Once every third Sunday of the blue moon after the vernal equinox, you know, or you have some far-fetched idea once a year about taking the Lord's Supper. But if you don't rightly divide the word of truth, you will come to all kinds of conclusions about the Lord's Supper. Now, there's a number of accounts of the Lord's Supper where it was instituted, where it was established in the Bible record for us. And I want you to notice some of these. In Matthew 26 and verse 26, this is what Jesus said by Mark's account. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. Verse 27, and he took the cup and gave thanks and gave to them, saying, drink ye all of it. Now, the question that we're discussing tonight has to do with the cup. Is it required that when you're partaking the Lord's Supper that you use only one cup? And if you use more than one cup, it's a sin. Now, that's the question tonight. The individuals that we're talking about, that we've been in contact with, or who have asked us these questions, are under the impression that it is wrong, and actually went so far to say that it's causing division to use more than one, and actually went so far to say that it was a sin if we use more than one. Well, I hope to change your minds on that. I'm going to give them some Bible to consider this. But notice this. That's Matthew's account. Now, in Mark chapter 14, let me get back up here. I'm not quite used to this new format I'm using. Mark chapter 14, in verse 22, listen to what the record says. And as they did eat, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave to them, and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. Now, again, the cup. Now, friends, what I want you to consider, those two verses seem to indicate that there was one cup. Well, I'm not disputing that he took one cup and that he did something with one cup. But the question that we are considering is the focus on the vessel or is it on the content? Listen, when the Bible speaks, sometimes it uses that figure of speech, that metonymy, putting one thing for another, and it does so in this case. Look, the Bible speaks of the container when it's talking really about the contents. Jesus said, take this cup and drink ye all of it. He wasn't talking about the cup per se as much as he was focusing on the content, the fruit of the vine. The juice of the grape that represented his blood. How do I know? Because he said, take this cup, it is my blood. It's what he said in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 26. He wasn't concerned about the cup. as much as he was talking about the about the contents. Look, verse 28. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. He's talking about the contents of the cup, not the container itself. Paul does the same thing. Paul uses a metonymy when he says the cup, but he's clearly emphasizing the contents. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25. And I'm going to try to get through this so we can get to the phone lines. So bear with me, please. 1 Corinthians 11, 25. And after the same manner, Paul is telling what Jesus did. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. All right, so the cup is standing for the contents, the New Testament in his blood. It is the blood, or represents the blood that was shed to seal the New Testament that would ultimately bring salvation to everyone who would be obedient to Christ. Hebrews 5 and verse 9. Paul wants them to focus on the content, not the cup. Now notice what he says here. In 1 Corinthians 11, 27, he says, wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. You see what we're talking about? The bread represents the body, and the cup, the contents of it, represents the blood of the Lord. And so again, the focus or the significance is on the content, not on the cup. What is the significance of the container? Please tell me. What is the importance of the container? How big was the vessel? Was it tall, short, fat, small? How much did it hold? Do you know anything about the container? No, all you know is that it was a container that was holding the fruit of the vine that our Lord and Savior used to demonstrate what they were to do in order to observe or remember this memorial feast. See, we know what the bread represents. It represents the body of Christ. We know what the fruit of the vine represents. It represents the blood of Christ. But no one can tell you what the actual cup stands for. No one can tell you what the actual cup represents or what the significance is, other than a container was needed to hold this liquid that Christ used. See? But what I want to show you, friends, is when we're talking about a metonymy, when we're talking about using one thing for another thing, sometimes a singular item can be used to represent multiple items. And that's what I'm going to show you. And that's why when we partake of the Lord's Supper on the first day of the week, we will use multiple cups, and it's not a sin. Because we are still doing what the Lord says do, whether we have one cup, two cups, 20 cups, or 1,000 cups. Now watch this. Watch this. The cup can stand for multiple cups. In Mark 9, verse 41, Mark 9, 41, Jesus said, for whosoever shall give you a cup of water to drink in my name because you belong to Christ, verily I say unto you, he shall not lose his reward. Now, ask yourself this, neighbor. If Jesus says give a cup of water in his name, what if you gave two cups of water in his name? Are you going to be condemned? Are you going to lose your salvation? Are you going to be lost because you gave two cups instead of one? Or in this case, does a cup stand for multiple cups? Look at this. The cup of blessing. Paul spoke of the cup of blessing in 1 Corinthians 10, 16. He says, the cup of blessing which we bless. Now stop and think with me. Where is Paul when he's writing this? First, who's he writing to? He's writing to the Corinthians. I believe he's in Philippi. It doesn't really matter where he is, but I know this. Wherever he is not Corinth. Because he says he's going to come through Macedonia, and then he's going to stay a while in Ephesus when he comes to the Corinthians. Now, I want you to think about this. Paul was writing to people in Corinth. And wherever he was also partaking of the Lord's Supper every first day of the week as he gave command to all the churches. 1 Corinthians 4:17. I speak the same thing in all churches, Paul said. He gave the same command to the church of Galatia as he did to the churches at Corinth. 1 Corinthians 16:1 and 2. So whatever he's telling them to do in Corinth, he's doing the same thing wherever he is. Now, if each congregation, let's say there's three congregations involved here. If there are three congregations, and on the first day of the week they're partaking of the Lord's Supper, can you say they're all drinking of the cup of blessing? Are they all partaking of the cup of blessing? You know they are. They could very well all be reading this very letter that Paul is writing, like we do. We read from 1 Corinthians 10 on the first day of the week, or 1 Corinthians 11. And we talk about the cup of blessing which we bless. We talk about the cup, the Lord's cup, as it's called. Now, if there are a number of congregations doing this, aren't they using multiple cups? See? The cup of blessing is being represented by multiple cups, even if it's just one in each one of these congregations. For example, if the church at Danville only had one cup, and the church in Martinsville only had one cup, and the church that meets in Eden has one cup, there's three different cups, but yet it's all the cup of the Lord. See, multiple cups can be taken from a simple statement of one cup. Look at this. In 2 Kings 4:38, I want to show you that multiple vessels can still be called one vessel. Elisha came to Gilgal, and there was a dearth in the land. The sons of the prophets were sitting before him, and he said to the servant, "Set on the great pot and seethe pottage for the sons of the prophets." All right? Put the pot on the fire, the great pot, the big pot, and let's cook something. Let's cook some food. And one went out into the field to gather herbs and found a wild vine and gathered thereof a wild gourds, his lap full, and shred them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. So they poured out for the men to eat. All right? They poured out of this one pot for everybody to eat. They didn't all take a spoon and dip into that one pot. They all poured out, and they all had their own vessels. But look at this. It came to pass as they were eating the pottage that they cried out and said, "O thou man of God, there is death in the pot," and they could not eat thereof. Death was in the pot, and they couldn't eat thereof. They weren't eating out of the one pot, though, were they? Yes, they were all eating out of the one pot. But it just so happened, the way they were eating out of one pot was they were all eating out of individual vessels. They poured out of the great pot into individual serving containers, but yet when they said, "Wait, there's death," they didn't go, "Oh no, there's death in the individual eating containers." They said, "No, there's death in the pot," because they were all eating of the pot. See, they were eating the contents of the one vessel, even though they were all eating from individual vessels. Still spoken of as being the pot. Death is in the pot, and they could not eat thereof. They couldn't eat of that pot, even though they were eating of it in such a way that each had their own individual bowl or vessel. See, when the Bible talks about partaking of the contents of one vessel, it can be done in such a manner that you have multiple vessels. And you still say, I'm eating out of that one pot. I'm still eating out of that one pot, partaking of that one pot. You want another one? How about this? How about Jacob's well? In John 4, verse 9, Jesus is sitting at the well in Samaria. The woman comes up, and he said to the woman of Samaria, give me something to drink. Then saith the woman of Samaria to him, "How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." Jesus answered and said unto her, "If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, 'Give me to drink,' thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. And the woman said unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Now watch it. Is that a singular vessel? The well?
Yeah.
That's just like the cup that Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians 11. It's just like the cup that Christ used on the day when he instituted the Lord's Supper. So the well is singular. The well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Now stop and think about that. They all drank of the well. She said, art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? How did they get down to the water? How did they drink of that well? How did they all drink of it? Did they lower themselves down one at a time in order to put their lips to the water and drink some of it? Can you imagine them all drinking of the well and their cattle? Well, let's see. Let's get the mama cow. Let's lower her down there so she can get a drink. We'll pull her back up. Then we'll put another cow down there and let it get some water. And then we'll pull it up. We'll put one of our sheep down there. Let it get some drink so that we all can drink from the well. Then we'll lower the children down. Let them get a drink. You know? What'd they do? Hold them by their ankles so they can get a drink? No. They all drank from the well. How did they do it? Well, they used some kind of vessel to draw from that well. We know the lady left her water pot. So she was going to use something to get water out of the well, yet it was still called drinking from the well. They all drank from the well, even though they had another vessel. Did the Samaritan woman drink from the well? Yes. Did she drink from the well with Jacob and his children and his cattle? Yes. See? But they used a different vessel. I wonder if it was the same water pot. You know, we're drinking out of the same vessel. No, they're not drinking out of the same vessel. And I know they didn't drink out of the same vessel that the cows drank of, probably, the cattle. I don't know. But even if they did, friends, still she took a water pot and put it down in the well, because the well was deep, and she drew out water and she drank it, and that was called drinking from the well, even though the water simply came out of the well. So you can drink from one container. You can drink from one container by putting the contents in another container. You still say, I drank from that container. I drank from that container even though I didn't sip out of it. You know why these people have these food recalls? There's been a lot of food recalls, and you'll notice that the reason why they recall them is because the food comes from the same batch. See? That we want to get all the food that was produced on such and such batch, and they number all the batches of food. Well, people will get sick if they eat from the same batch. You mean tell me you're drinking from the same container? Well, yeah, in a sense I am. You're eating from the same poison batch of food? Yeah. I got E. coli from this batch. Can you imagine a man in Florida getting sick like a man in Michigan getting sick? Yeah, the reason why is because they ate from the same spoiled food source. Even though they're far apart, they can still eat from the same batch. See? And that's what I'm saying, friends. When Christ was talking about drink this cup, and Paul said drink this cup, he wasn't talking about the cup. He was talking about the contents and what it represented. That's the point we're making. And that's why when it comes to observing the Lord's Supper, and Paul says, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord, he's not talking about drinking out of one individual cup. He's talking about drinking a cup that represents the blood of Christ. That's the cup of the Lord. And that's why you can have the church at Corinth saying, well, we drink of the cup of the Lord. And you can have the church at Ephesus saying, well, we drink of the cup of the Lord. And you can have the church at Philippi going, we drink of the cup of the Lord. And they all drank of the singular cup of the Lord. And there's one, two, three cups that are represented there. Now, here's my question, friend. If the cup of the Lord can be represented by one individual cup in each congregation, and thus you have multiple cups representing this cup, why can't you have multiple cups in the congregation representing the same cup of the Lord? It's not about the cup. It's about the content. It's not about the container. It's about the content. What's in it? You see? And that's why it's ridiculous to say you have to use the cup. Friends, you don't know what the cup was. Again, was it a tall cup, short cup? What was it made out of? Do you have the cup? And if you have the cup, how does everybody else partake of the Lord's Supper? You know, that cup would have to get around faster than Santa Claus every week for every Christian to partake of that cup. So, you know, I'm simply asking you, do you really have to have one cup or can you use multiple cups? And if you aren't convinced now, will you consider one more argument and then we'll open the phone lines? I want you to listen to what Luke says in Luke 22:17. Jesus instituting the Lord's Supper, he took the cup, singular, and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. Now that word divide means to partition thoroughly, literally in distribution. So distribute this cup among yourselves. Now let's think about that. Let's go back to that pot of pottage in 2 Kings 4. Did they divide the contents of that pot to the men? Yes, they poured it out for the men. Did they all say they ate of the pot? Yes, they did. They simply divided the contents and they ate out of their own vessels. But yet they still said they ate out of the pot. Jesus took the cup and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. Distribute it among yourselves. Now friends, when you distribute something, you don't pass one vessel around and each take a sip of it. You distribute it. Here's the same word that's used in Matthew 27:35. And notice what they did when they divided. Matthew 27:35, they crucified him and parted his garment, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them. Now, friends, they didn't take his garment and say, well, I'll wear it one day and then you wear it the next day. And then, here, Tychicus can wear it on Tuesday and Spartacus can wear it on Wednesday and so forth. No, they divided the garments. Look, Mark 15:24, and when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them what every man should take. Jesus said, do the same thing with the cup. Now, he didn't break the cup. He said, divide the contents. Divide it among yourselves. You know what I say, friend? I say, when I'm taking the Lord's Supper, I can take the fruit of the vine and I can divide it amongst the brethren in individual cups, and we can all partake of the fruit of the vine and do exactly what Jesus said. Every man taking his part. of that cup of blessing which we bless. Every man taking his part of the fruit of the vine that represents the blood of Christ. See how easy that is? Now, you may have some discussion about that. I don't know. We'll put the phone lines up. But again, remember this. The big issue, the big picture is, it's not so much whether you want, whether it's the cups or not. What we're talking about is authority. If you don't understand Bible authority, then you're going to come to some conclusions that may lead you down a road that will lead you to say, well, this is wrong, when really it may be all right. See? You're on the word of the Lord.
Hey, Brother Dave, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well.
I was saying, I don't understand. You don't drink out of the same cup. Well, when Jesus was living, right before he died, got crucified, they all drank out of the same cup.
How do you know that? I just read this verse right here. It says he took the cup and said, divide it among yourselves. How do they divide it?
They drink out of the same cup as in the Bible.
How do you divide the contents of the cup when it all stays in the same cup?
And they broke bread together.
You're not answering my question, ma'am. You made a statement here that you haven't given proof. I know they broke bread. But my question is, how did they divide the cup?
I don't know.
By keeping it all in the same cup.
I believe it was the same cup.
Well, but your belief and what we find in the scripture is different. See, I'm saying he took a cup and said, divide it amongst yourselves. Now, how do you divide a cup among yourselves and still leave it in the vessel?
Share it.
I'm sorry?
You share it.
All right. Well, I can share it, but that doesn't mean I leave it in the same cup. Let's say I had a bottle of Dr. Pepper, and I divided it among everybody here at the station, you know what? I could pour it in their glass and divide it, but I wouldn't divide it amongst themselves by leaving it in the bottle. Now, we might share it, we might all drink out of it, but it wouldn't be dividing it amongst ourselves.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying? So, everybody gets their part.
It's not the same cup, right?
That's what I'm saying. Do you use one cup in your worship?
Yes, sir.
All right. So would I? Am I wrong for not using one cup?
No.
Okay. So I don't have a problem with you using it. If you want to drink after everybody, that's fine.
No.
But I'm saying, don't tell me it's wrong for me to use multiple cups. You see? Because I know Jesus said divide it.
Okay.
See?
You got the point.
Okay. All right.
And I appreciate that.
All right. Thanks for it. You're watching on the internet?
No, sir.
You're picking us up on antenna?
Uh-huh.
Okay. All right. All right. Thanks for watching.
Thank you, Mr.
Opium. Uh-huh. All right. I thought maybe that would be somebody online I could see where she was from out of town, but apparently she's not so far out of town she can't pick us up on the antenna. But, I would like to hear some of you individuals, if you're watching and you're the ones who has emailed me or something like this, you know, if you want to call and take issue with it, I'd be glad to hear from you, you know, because to me it's an important matter. Not so much about the Lord's Supper, per se, as much as the big picture. We're talking about authority, knowing why we're doing what we're doing. And like I said, the reason why it's so important is because if you don't know why you're doing what you're doing, then it's going to lead you down a slippery slope. Now, here's something else we need to consider. The lesson that we're trying to drive home is this. You need to be concerned about what God says do. There are certain things that we have liberty in. If he says go and teach all nations, you have liberty in how you go. You can take a plane, you can take a train, you can take a car, you know, you can take a boat. You know, those are means of going. He doesn't say how to go. But he does tell you to go, and he tells you what to teach. In this situation, God tells us what to eat. Unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine. Those are the examples that we have. That's what he used when he instituted the Lord's Supper and said, take this and eat, and take this and drink. So the question is not, you know, the question is not what vessel are these things in, but so much as what are they? You're on a word from the Lord.
Good evening, James. How you doing?
I'm doing just marvelous.
That's good. You know, another way to reiterate your point about the cup, the particular cup, is in 1 Corinthians 11:25.
Right.
It says, after the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Well, if it was this cup, that cup that he had 2,000 years ago, well, then does that mean that all the cups that are being used now aren't?
We'd have to have that cup, wouldn't we?
Well, that would mean that if the cups that we're using today, if it had to be that cup, he said this cup,
mm-hmm.
that means the cups we're using today aren't considered the New Testament in my blood.
Well, I think the individuals who would take a contrary position would say, no, the emphasis is just on the singular cup. But see, I don't see how you can make that distinction. Why would he just be talking about a singular cup, but not but not saying this specific cup?
Right. Well, he didn't say any singular cup is the New Testament in my blood. He said this cup. So
right.
If they're going to be that specific, and they don't understand, you know, as you pointed out, that vessel isn't what's being talked about.
Right. It's the content.
So with this cup or that cup that he used, wasn't it?
Right. So, yeah, I mean, that's what I think, too. I mean, you have to say, you know, that particular cup. But, again, it gets back to the point we're trying to make here is if you're not careful about listening to, you know, what God says, you know how it is sometimes if I say something or say you send something to me and I don't listen carefully, I may think I heard you, and I'll wind up doing something that you didn't tell me to do. You know, so I have to listen carefully. Take heed how you hear is what Jesus said. Well, if we don't listen to God very carefully, we may start doing something and saying something's wrong, like it's a sin if we use multiple cups. Now, the lady that called in previously, she didn't say it was a sin. But the brother that I talked to in Arkansas, he actually said it's a sin if you use multiple cups. And that's what I'm saying. He's going down a road, you know, that's actually binding what God didn't bind. God didn't say I had to use one cup. He just told me what to put in the cup.
Well, like you also pointed out already, if it is that we're to use a single cup, then how would you get it from congregation to congregation throughout the world?
Right.
Well, and, thank you.
And if each congregation has one cup, then you have multiple cups representing the cup of the Lord. So.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks for your call. And see, friends, I'm hoping that people said, I appreciate the lady that called earlier, you know, and recognized, you know, said I made a point. You know, the point I'm making is God didn't say what vessel or what kind of vessel. He just said, take the content. Because name one, tell me how you're going to divide a liquid up without putting it in some vessel. I mean, a liquid has to have a vessel. It has to have something to hold it in. So we're not talking about the expedient, which is the cup. We're talking about the contents. God told us what to eat, and he even told us when to eat it upon the first day of the week. If you partake of the Lord's Supper on Thursday night or Friday night or Saturday night or, you know, the second Tuesday of the month, that's the wrong day. God, in his word, has given us an example of them coming together upon the first day of the week to break bread, Acts 20, verse 7. That's when they came together to partake of the Lord's Supper. And so nothing is said really about the container. And it brings up a lot of other issues. Now you say, well, James, why does it really matter? Well, take this call. You're on Word from the Lord.
Yes. I was going to ask the question.
All right.
Okay, it's dealing with what he's talking about right now.
Okay.
All right. Should I tell you my question?
You're on the air.
This is he.
I'm James.
You're what?
You're on the air.
Okay. What I was going to ask was the wine at the supper fermented or not fermented?
It was unleavened, non-fermented.
Well, I have read and have come to understanding that the Last Supper was like 6 to 7 months after the harvest of wine.
And?
Now, wouldn't that make it fermented?
No.
The Jews had
way of preserving. Had a way of preserving juice where it wouldn't ferment. I mean, they weren't that backward.
Okay.
You know, here's how they do it. One way they did it was they would boil it down to a thick paste,
uh-huh.
You know, like a concentrate.
Yes.
And then they could reconstitute it with water. And it's still juice. You know, it's not fermented at all. I'm just saying that's one way. But no, it wasn't fermented. Here's another thing, too, is if you'll look in, well, let me just see if I can pull up here. Exodus 12. And I'm looking for all the leaven was out of the house.
Uh-huh.
Let's see. Well, 15. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day shall ye put away leaven out of your houses. All right, here it is. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread, and even the first day shall ye put away leaven out of your houses. Whosoever eateth unleavened bread from the first day until the seventh shall be cut off. My point is, all the leaven had to be put out of the house for the Passover. So nothing fermented, nothing... you know, nothing leaven, no leaven bread, no leaven fruit of the vine. And that, so that's what they would be using for the Lord's Supper as well.
Okay, I'm not calling to, you know, to justify drinking because
I understand.
Don't drink anyhow.
Right, I understand.
I was just curious about that.
Yeah. Unfermented wine.
Okay, unfermented, okay. Unfermented. All right, well, thanks a lot there.
Thanks for your call. Oh, yeah, okay. All right. Yeah, I would, and there's another verse there if I could find it. Probably had to be, that's when it was called the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, by the by. So, I don't know if I can find a cross reference on that Exodus 12:15. But anyway, all the leaven put out of the house. So, we're not talking about the container, we're talking about the cup. So, not the content. Now, why is this important? Well, again, it gets down to understanding what God says. If you don't realize how God talks, and you don't realize that He's using a figure of speech, using a metonymy, putting a one thing for another, the cup for the content, then it can lead you to do things that God wouldn't want you to do. And the same reason why we stress authority all the time, friends, is because God tells us what He wants, and if we don't listen to Him or we don't pay attention to what He wants, then we'll give Him something different than what He wants. You're on the Word from the Lord.
James, how are you tonight?
I'm doing well.
I'm lost.
Okay, I know that. You're in the Christian church.
In the old Bible and the Passovers, was that for the Jews only? Was that for the Gentiles?
Say again, the Passover?
The Passover, yeah. Was that for the... Did they have four Passovers a year?
No, just one Passover a year.
I thought I read in the old Bible that the Passover was for the Jews. That's when they passed over all the male children.
Right. That's when it started, Exodus 12.
Right.
And they observed it every year. That was the beginning of their year.
And I didn't think they...
But I'm missing your point.
as Gentile Christians today, we don't have Passover, do we?
Well, we have a meal where we remember Christ as our Passover, 1 Corinthians 5:7. Look where Paul says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened, for Christ our Passover is crucified for us. So when we remember Christ's death and his burial and his resurrection, we're remembering his Passover sacrifice, if you will.
Without death, burial, and resurrection, right?
Right. But I'm saying, but he was crucified at the Passover. At the same time that the Jews were killing their Passover lambs, Christ, the Lamb of God, was slain for the sins of the world. Same day, same time. He became our Passover.
Someplace in a book, I was in Greek or Hebrew, that they used watered-down wine for the Lord's Supper in the cup.
Well, I don't know what you mean by watered down, but I know it wasn't fermented. Like was said to the previous caller, it was
they
unleavened.
Spices to weaken it down, you know.
Well, I mean, when you say weaken down, you're not talking about to make it less intoxicating. You're talking about just to
take the alcohol contents out of it.
Yeah, no, I'm not saying that. I'm saying it wasn't any alcohol in to start with. It was unfermented. It was simply the juice, the fruit of the vine. It wasn't fermented at all.
Okay, well, glad to see you back.
All right.
See you.
All right, so, but here's what we're talking about before we wrap up. If we're not careful about how we listen to God, we'll start giving him things that he doesn't want, like what was talked about earlier, BTW, anything goes. You know, you see the church around here, anything goes. Well, this is why. They're not careful about how they listen to God. Your own word from the Lord.
Hey, James.
Hey.
On the note of paying attention to God, the second to last caller said, talking about the Lord's blood being called wine, and I can't find any place in Scripture actually calls it wine.
The what? The
function, really.
The what's used in the Lord's Supper being called wine?
Right, as opposed to like the fruit of the vine or the cup.
Right. Well, that's a good point. In Bible times, wine was a generic term that could refer to fermented or unfermented. But you're right; it's always referred to as fruit of the vine when it's regarded to as the Lord's Supper. It kind of takes away any doubt, I suppose.
Yeah. Thank you, James. Good job.
All right, you're on word from the Lord. Last call.
Hello, James. This is Jeff. I'm one of the guys that emailed you.
Oh, yeah.
I want to say thanks for doing this lesson. It's helped me out tremendously on my questions.
Okay.
Thanks.
Well, I appreciate you watching. And you're watching from where?
Tennessee.
Tennessee. Okay. Well, appreciate you watching. Yeah, I didn't know if you got my email tonight or not. I told you I was going to be talking about this. I don't know if you got that or not. But anyway, I'm glad you tuned in, glad you watched it, and hope it helped.
Yep.
All right. Well, thanks for your call.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. So one of the guys that emailed was watching. So glad that happened. Yep. So friends, before we close, just realize we're talking about the importance of listening to God, knowing how God talks, how he talks to us. If we misunderstand it, we might get down a long road away from anything he wants. We're trying to help you know the will of God, Ephesians 5:17. That's our goal. That's our desire. And if we can help you in any way, we want to do that. We want to remind you of how you can reach us, contact us. We're meeting at 250 Boulevard there in Eden, 276-340-2653, 336-394-5721. If you want to reach me, wordfromthelord@gmail.com. Till next time, friends, thanks for watching. Always ask, what does the Bible say? And you'll always get a word from the Lord. Have a good night.
I couldn't stand Johnny at first. I thought he was a nut. And once I read the Bible for myself, I'm able to accept the truth now.
All right.
And it doesn't make me angry.
I'm talking about the Lauren Hardy Show on Wednesday. Don't worry about them. Some of y'all, get off of it, would you?